diga.
You are awesome, Lord.
You are awesome in this place. Abba Father.
You are Lord, how worthy, yes, you are.
You are worthy of all praise.
You will as we raise.
To you will as we raise. You are awesome in this place.
Praise the Lord. We serve an awesome God. Hallelujah. Anybody feeling an awakening and a quickening in your spirit? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I praise God for what he's doing in my own heart and in the hearts of the brethren around me. Hallelujah. And that's a part of his awesomeness. He is awesome in this place, in these temples. He is awesome. Amen. and amen. Glory to God. We have our apostle, and she is coming very shortly to continue, hallelujah, to give us what's on her heart, hallelujah. But tonight I'm excited, and like I keep saying, I feel like the expectancy that he's placed within us, it's almost like it's expanding to receive more. I don't even know if that makes any sense. But really, there's something in us that it's making room for more. And I'm excited about what the Lord is doing. Surely he has a set of people that will continue to walk in holiness. Surely he has a set of people that he's going to be delighted in. That he will say, like he has said of his first son, well done, and this is my beloved. These are my beloved, in whom I'm well pleased. Hallelujah. I just have so much expectation. I think it's kind of, you know, feel God is about to do a thing. It's almost like it's tickling. You know, I'm excited about the Lord. Because there is something about living clean. There's something about living holy. There's something about having an apostle in the house to guide and to bring us into perfection. Hallelujah. And I feel that amongst us. I feel that lightness and that expectancy and expectation of him. Of him. I expect great things of the Lord this year. Great, great, and awesome things of the Lord. Amen. I don't want to lose my expectation. I have great hope in him. In fact, all my hope is in him. All our hope is in him. And we don't want to let go of that. Amen. He's our life. He's our hope. He's our expectancy and our expectation. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Yes, Apostle. Let's just stand and welcome our Apostle. Hallelujah. In the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen.
It would be tragic if I failed. Praise the Lord. You may be seated, saints, in his presence. Praise the Lord. Isn't God good, saint? Yes. He's just good. I'm telling you, I'm like Pastor Leverage. I'm just loving God. Just, it's so light. Don't we feel light? And there's a lightness, amen, in the ministry. We're not all weighted down, and God just doing a thing in us, saints. And I'm glad, because that means that we're moving on. We, you know, when you lay aside the weights, you can travel. You can run the race then. Glory to God. Well, we thank God for being God. Amen. We thank him for being God, and we thank him for where he's brought us to and where he's going to take us. Glory to God. We started a series Sunday that I want to pick up on tonight. And I've asked everyone to be present, because this is most serious. It's a most serious issue for the benefit of those who are online. Are we on yet? For the benefit of those who are online and on television, amen, we are ministering regarding the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper. Amen. That sacrament that the church, amen, performs as often as it will. Amen. I want you to get your Bibles. I want you to take notes let's go to the book of Corinthians. Get a monitor. Amen. Let us go to the book of Corinthians. 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter.
about the 17th verse, I believe. Just to set a starting point that picks up where we were in our last session on this subject. 1 Corinthians 11:17.
Now, in this that I declare unto you, I praise you not that ye come together, not for the better, but for the worse.
Now, first of all, let's remember that this is the Apostle Paul writing to the church. This is the Apostle Paul writing to the church. He's writing to the church at Corinth. And as I said to you before, there were a lot of problems in the Corinthian church. And it was the responsibility of the apostle to set things in order. But this is one of those churches that he preached out on his missionary journey. Glory to God. He was there and pastored for a season. He sent other pastors in to pastor. Glory to God, very much the same way we sent Pastor Reagan down to Trinidad. And glory to God, and Pastor McGirt in different places, Evangelist McGirt. Amen. So Paul was responsible. He was the apostle that had taken on the responsibility of this Gentile church. And as I said to you before, Corinth was a very prosperous city. Very prosperous. The people there were very prosperous. But they were also full of pride, and that pride carried over into the church. And it proves the Corinthian church is evidence that you really need strong leadership. You have to have strong leadership if the people of God are going to stay on course. They've got to follow. They got to sit up under strong leadership. Cannot be promiscuous. Amen? Bless the Lord. Well, I didn't get an amen on that, but anyway, it's still the truth. Praise the Lord. Now, Paul said to this church, he says, I don't praise you. I'm about to rebuke you. That's what I'm about to do. I'm about to rebuke you. And I want you to understand that is the essence of this whole teaching right here. It is a rebuke. It is a rebuke. When he teaches the Lord's Supper, he teaches it inside of a rebuke. And the reason for that is because they were doing just the opposite of what they had ought to be doing. What they had ought to be doing. Amen. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. So he says that I'm offering a rebuke here, because when you come together, you're not coming together for the better, but you're coming together for the worse. Amen? Read on.
For first of all, when you come together in the church, mm-hmm. I hear that there be divisions among you, and I partly believe it.
Now, Paul said, I heard. He had some informants. He had some informants in that church. He said, I heard this, that there's division among you. And remember now, he's talking about the Lord's Supper. He's teaching on the Lord's Supper. But in order to teach it, look where he goes. I heard that there's division among you. Why would he place that in the midst of the teaching of the Lord's Supper? Glory to God. This is most necessary. Let me tell you why. Because of the elements of the Lord's Supper. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing? And see, they didn't do, in that day, they had this thing all messed up, some of these Corinthians, glory to God, because they were bringing their own meals to the church. Is that right? They were bringing their own meals to the church, and every family was having their own whatever. And then there were, as I said before, there were some families that didn't have anything or had very little. And so That was shameful as far as Paul was concerned. That was shameful. I think we went through that in our last session. That's not that should not be. He said, if you're going to have a banquet, if you're going to have a banquet where you know, everyone is not able to partake of the same amount of food or whatever, then eat at home. Don't come to church and do it. Are you hearing him? Don't bring that into the house of God, amen, because it's shameful for someone to sit in the house, don't have anything to eat, and everybody around them is eating. If you're not going to share with everybody, then don't bring it into God's house. That was his point. Are you working with me? Glory to God. So he says, there's divisions among you, and I partly believe it. We're going to see in a moment why this is so pertinent. Look at the 19th verse here.
For there must be also heresies among you, mm-hmm. that they which are approved may be made manifest among you.
Now someone was not in agreement with what the goings on of the Corinthian church. Being an apostle myself, I received reports from different churches, from different saints that says, you know, doc, this is happening or that's happening, whatever. They're not in agreement with it when it goes off course. And see, the people that are not in agreement with sin will be manifested in the midst of the goings on. So he said, there are heresies. Now notice what he says here. He's blaming, he's pointing the blame to there being heresies in that church. And what are heresies? Opinions. Opinions and beliefs that are contrary to sound doctrine. Beliefs or opinions that are profoundly at odds with that which is acceptable unto God. Profoundly at odds. That's what they call a heresy. That's what the scripture, that's how the scripture defines a heresy. That which is not a belief system. A belief system. An opinion. And this is very, very severe because, you know, why is he bringing these things up with the Lord's Supper? Because we have been able to look at our lives and see that we're not in blatant sin. We're not smoking, drinking, clubbing, fornicating, none of those things. We're not doing any of those obvious sins. But if God has ministered something and you are not in agreement with the word of God, if you're not in agreement, then you have heresy in your heart. You have heresy in your heart. And many people are partaking of the Lord's Supper with heresy in their heart. When is this so pertinent? Let me tell you what I have seen and how it is manifest that heresy is in the heart. When you hear a teaching and you may not agree with it, if Pastor George listened to me teach on a subject and he does not agree with what I teach, he has the responsibility to come to me because I'm the teacher. He has that responsibility to come to me and say, Doc, I have a problem with this doctrine you're teaching. Help me here. Now he has placed the responsibility on me to bring clarity. Now when he comes, the reason he does not believe is because probably he has some other scriptures that seem to contradict what I'm teaching. Now, if I can set him down and show him the meaning of those scriptures, or show him scriptures that directly contradict his opinion or his belief. If I can open that Bible up and show him scriptures, not my opinion, but scriptures that directly contradict what he believes, that ought to be enough for him. That ought to be enough to change his mind. If it doesn't, if the scriptures are not enough to change his mind, it's because he has heresy in his heart. And he's not ready to purge himself of that heresy. Sometimes there's reasons. There's external reasons for that. It might be that he has convinced his wife of his belief. He's convinced his children. He's convinced fellow pastors, people in his territorial sphere of influence. Perhaps he's convinced them of his belief. And now I have revealed to him that it is not right. He's reading it for himself. He's reading the contradiction for himself. If he's not ready, if he has any degree of pride, if he's not ready to go back to those people, to his wife, to his children, to his fellow leaders, and say, you know what, I was wrong. I sat down with the apostle and she brought clarity to it, and there's some scriptures here that just knocked that right out of the ballpark. Because his objective ought to be to get to the truth. Not to prove he's right or me wrong, but to get to the truth. Are you hearing? But when the objective is to prove the other person wrong, when that's the motivation, glory to God, you'll stick with your wrong, because it's very difficult to relinquish that pride and say, you know what, I was just wrong. I'm just wrong. Are you hearing God? That's heresy in the heart. Now, he may not be a drinker, a smoker, or a drunkard, or a fornicator, or a liar, or a thief, or none of that. But he has a heresy in his heart. He does not agree with God. He does not agree with God's word. And he's, on first Sunday, he comes up and take communion. Hello? He comes up and take communion. Another example of this, and I see this in some people, and I used to be here, Lord, I used to be right here, and God had to really school me. Hallelujah. There are some people, watch this, God will give a mandate. God's word tells us how to deal with sin. Let's use that as an example. That's handy. God's word tells us how to deal with sin, right? Tells us how to deal with sin in leaders. It tells us how to deal with sin in anybody. He just tells us how to deal with sin in the church. And we try our best to do what he say. But sometimes our emotions get in the way. Because sometimes the people that sin are people that we love. There are some people that we love that are detrimental to the body of Christ. Come on, somebody. They're detrimental. Hallelujah. To the body of Christ. And God would say to us in a situation like that, especially of unrepented sin, and especially in people that have no love for the people of God, that have no regard for the people of God or how they hurt the people of God. Glory to God. God would say, leave it alone. Let me deal with that. You go through the process that I gave you in the scripture to deal with it. Now leave it alone. Let me handle it from there. Let me tell you something. If you don't agree with that, you know what you're going to do? You're going to hold hands with that sin.
Oh, come on. I'm talking about people that are taking communion unworthily because they have not followed the instructions of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. And they think they're all right. They believe that they're all right because they're not fornicators. They're not liars. They're not thieves. They're not whatever. They just don't agree with God. They don't agree with his way of handling things. God said to me, he said, the ministry would have been a lot further along had you really stuck to the discipline that I put in the scripture. And I didn't, Ricky, in the name of love. I went overboard in forbearing. And in doing so, there was so much damage done to people. People were hurt. People were hurt. There's some people that were hurt that won't even come to the church. Damaged by leaders and ministers in the church. Lady called me the other day and said, I had such a bad experience in the church. Bad experience. And I've never set foot there again. Hallelujah. And I said, darling, we must continue on in God and put things behind us. But let me tell you something, saints. If you don't agree with God, see, if God give that mandate and you don't agree with it, you're going to find your way of bringing deliverance in the lives of people that God say, turn them out. Leave them alone. Let me deal with them. Why does he say that? Why does he tell you to do that? He might tell you to do that to your own child. He may tell you to do that to your son or your daughter. Say, leave him alone. Told me to do that to Michael. Leave him alone. Just leave him alone. Pray for him if you want to pray for him. But I counseled till I was blue in the face. And God said, leave him alone. I know how to deal with him. God put him in a place where he had to listen. At 18 years old, on your way to prison. Mm-hmm. And gave me peace. I'm the one turned him in. Are you hearing God? Gave me peace, turned him in, got in the car the same night and went straight to Canada. Drove 30 hours to Canada, do a crusade. God gave me peace, even with my baby going to jail. Are you hearing God? And I say, God, he's in your hands because you told me to leave him alone. Now, he's in a lot of trouble here, but he's still in your hands because you love him more than I do. And sometimes we can't see that. Sometimes we can't see that God is saying, leave things alone. Do what I told you to do in the script. And after you do that, it's my time now. Because if you don't get the results, those good results after you've done what I say do, then now leave it alone. Let me do what I do. And another reason God says that is because he knows the influence of iniquity and sin. And he knows that it's infectious. And he knows that it's influential. He knows that some people cannot handle dealing with folks that are outside the boundaries of the faith. I don't care how long some of you have been in the church, you're not spiritual enough to deal with certain situations. You're not spiritual enough to deal with certain people that are skillful in the art of deceit. You're not skillful enough. You're easy to be drawn in because people will play on your emotions. Come on, are you hearing? And that's why God say, leave that alone.
Leave it alone. Do what I said in the script. Follow the leading of the Holy Ghost, because you are not able to do what you think you can do. Are you hearing God? That doesn't mean you give up hope for people, but it means you get out of the way and you don't become a stumbling block to the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost wants us to be peacemakers. And that means that we don't interfere with the operation of the Holy Ghost in our own lives or in the lives of others. Let God do what he's doing. There were people that I wanted to bring back into my bosom, and I was just so, grieved with their disposition in God. And my son could see, because he wasn't blinded by emotion. And he could see, he said, Mama, Christ has not been formed in that. That's dangerous to the body. And it would only take the truth with me. It just takes the truth with me. Once I hear the truth, that's it. It bears witness with my spirit. Once it bears witness with my spirit, there's no controversy. I'm not going to argue with that. There's no controversy. And when people are easily deceived, because sometimes we are so spiritual, we think we're so spiritual that we can't be deceived. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. The moment you don't agree with God, you can be deceived by cunning craftiness and feigned words. Are you hearing God? This makes us unworthy of communion. We don't agree. Remember the three? We have to agree. We have to agree. That's number one. We have to agree with God. We have to agree with God. We have to believe in the power of the Word of God. Let the Word do what the Word does. There are people that have defamed God and defamed his way, and they've gone on and, they just trotting, and all of a sudden that Word, see, they didn't understand that the Word is living, it's alive, and that Word will turn and fight against you. Hallelujah. So in order to be eligible to take communion, you got to agree with God. In every area, you must agree. Hallelujah. Are you working with me? You must agree and you must believe. So if God tell us to handle certain things a certain way, agree with him. Agree with him. These are just some living examples that I see going on in the church. I see saints setting themselves up. I see some of you're trying to go in God. God has given you ministry. God has given you the ability to minister. He set you up in ways that you never were set up before, to perform ministry, to glorify him. You got one hand on the gospel plow and the other one back here, holding hands with someone that God has rejected. Hallelujah. That doesn't feel good for me, especially if these people, if people that God has rejected are people that I've raised in the ministry. Sometimes it's people you've raised. Sometimes it's your own children. There are some parents that can't move because their children are outside of the boundaries of the faith, and they can't move in God because their heart is tied up back here, and they're all their activities, they're trying to go, but they're steady looking back. You can't put your hand on the gospel plow looking back. Can't plow a straight row looking back. God loves your child more than you do. Are you hearing? Turn that child over to God. agree with God that he is powerful enough to deal with where they are. It doesn't matter if they go to Timbuktu. God is in Timbuktu. Are you hearing God? He's there. So let's agree with God, and let's not use and hide behind our emotions for people that we love to keep from obeying God. Do what the scriptures say in every situation. Because if you're not going to agree with God and do what the scriptures say, you're not going to be worthy of the Lord's body. You're not worthy of it. You got to agree with God. And these things that deal with our emotions and our little love bones, glory to God, those things are things that make us unworthy because they carry us outside of the boundaries of the faith. And we think it's all right because it's an expression of love. No, it's an expression of disobedience. There are people that hallelujah, that will do wrong. And when they face someone that they know is in touch with God, they'll admit to their wrong and they'll weep and wail and cry and mourn because they have done wrong with an Esau spirit. You know why? Because when they get with someone that has less discerning, someone that is less spiritual, they feel that they can beguile that person. Are you hearing God? And some of you have been through things like that. And they can beguile. Because they're cunning and crafty. Very cunningly crafty. Because a person that is not ready to agree with God examines what's before him and determines how he can manipulate or deal with that which before him. And that's why God says some of you are not strong enough to deal with people that are skillful in the art of cunning craftiness and deceit. So agree with God and go on and do the thing God called you to do. Go on and perfect yourself, perfect your ministry. Walk in the faith. Are you hearing God? And stop allowing emotions to pull you back and cause you to stagger your emotions. You're hiding behind emotions and love that you have for people that you love. But it's making you disobedient to God. God said, do you think you can do more than I can? You can do more in a person's life than I can? If I give you instruction, why not follow my instruction? If you don't follow my instruction, that means that you think you can do more than I can. You don't agree with me. Are you hearing God? I didn't intend to go this extensive inside of that, but somebody needs this. Somebody needs this. Agreement with God. In all things. Hallelujah. Are you working with me? Are you working with me? Praise the Lord. Now, what does this say? Read.
When he come together, therefore, into mm-hmm. one place, mm-hmm. this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. For in eating, everyone taketh before other his own supper, mm-hmm. and one is hungry and another is drunken. Mm-hmm. What? Have ye not houses to eat and drink in? Or despise ye the church of God, and shame them that have not? What shall I say to you? Mm-hmm. Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not.
Mm-hmm. Then that's a sharp rebuke there. That's a sharp rebuke. Hallelujah. Read.
For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Mm-hmm. This do in remembrance of me. Mm-hmm. After the same manner, also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. Mm-hmm. This do ye as oft as he drink it in remembrance of me.
Now, notice what he's saying here. Let's look at what he's saying here. Glory to God. Hallelujah. He's saying, what I gave you, I got from God. That's a good thing. In other words, he says, I'm not preaching my opinion or how I think it ought to go. But this revelation came directly from God. Are you hearing it? Hallelujah. 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 Ooh, thank you, Jesus. Saints, it's a good thing to know Jesus. It's a good thing to know the truth. It's a good thing. I want us to go back to the book of Exodus, and let's look at the first Passover, because that's what communion is. It's the Passover. Are you hearing God? It's the Passover. And let's look at the first one so we can understand the principles. You remember, I believe it was Peter saying that there's no private interpretation of the scripture, right? But the scriptures are given, even in the Old Testament, they're given as a schoolmaster for us. So we can extract the principles. They never change. The principles of God never, ever change. Some of his methodologies do, but his principles don't. Are you hearing? Because his methodologies are tied to his principles. Are you hearing God? Amen. Let's look in Exodus, the 12th chapter. And I think we can start reading about the 46th verse.
Exodus 12:46. In one house shall it be eaten.
Well, we might need to back up some. Back up to the 43rd verse.
And the Lord said unto Moses and Aaron.
Now, Moses and Aaron, hallelujah, Moses was a type of apostle. The apostle. Are you hearing God? And Aaron, amen, represented the priesthood. God said to Moses and Aaron, mm-hmm.
This is the ordinance of the Passover.
Now, I'm going to give you the laws, the rules, or regulations that pertain to Passover. Listen to him.
There shall no stranger eat thereof.
Uh-oh. Now, here we are. Let's look at the setting. They are in Egypt. They've been in captivity 400 years. Might have been 430 years. They've been in captivity over 400 years. Moses comes down now. Moses comes, sent by God to bring them out of captivity. He has worked 9 other miracles. The night of the Passover was the 10th miracle. The 10th plague came upon Egypt. The night of the death angel. Listen to it. It was the night of the death angel. And God told them to eat the Passover. Take a lamb. Put him up for 14 days. Set him aside.
He can't have a spot or a blemish. Hallelujah. And you know what he said to them? He said, now, when you cook him, there were some rules, some laws there. When you cook him, don't break in his bones. He was to be roasted. He wasn't to be steamed or broiled or whatever, all that other stuff that adds water to it. No, he's to be roasted. And you're to eat all of it. Don't leave any of him. And don't take any of it with you. Are you hearing God? These were things, and when we teach probably the tabernacle, we'll tell you what all of that means. Amen. We don't have time to go there yet. But they had the lamb, the roasted lamb that night. And the bitter herbs that are part of the Passover sacraments. And they had unleavened bread. They had unleavened bread. And remember now that the Lord told them, I think it's in this verse here. Let's see. Glory to God. Well, let me take one thing at a time. There shall no stranger eat thereof. What is a stranger? Someone, first of all, that's not a part of the nation of Israel. Hello? No stranger can eat of it. But now he had an exception here. Watch this. He had an exception here. Glory to God. He said this. He said, but every man's servant. Are you there? Look at 44. Will you read that?
But every man's servant that is bought from money, when thou hast circumcised him, then shall he eat thereof.
He may not have been born in the nation, but if you bought him, if he's your slave or your servant, you paid for him, you own him. After you circumcise him, then he can eat. See, because you bought him, then he's yours. So I look upon him and I see him as belonging to you. But if he's going to eat, because he's not born into this thing, he wasn't naturally born into Israel. He was bought into it. Then he's got to be circumcised. Are you hearing God? And circumcision was a sign of cleanliness, sanctification. Are you hearing God? And even if he's your servant, Pastor Ricky, if he's not circumcised, he can't eat. Because if he's not circumcised, I see him as a stranger. Are you hearing God? Are you hearing him? This was the laws. This is the principle of the communion. This is the principles. We're extracting the principles out of the old covenant. Just the principles. We don't have to go back and roast the lamb to have the communion. We don't have to eat the bitter herbs. But we got to follow the principle. Come on, are you hearing God? Are you hearing him? So if he's not circumcised, I don't care if he belongs to you, saith the Lord. If he's not circumcised, he's not to be a partaker of the communion. Are you working with me? Praise the Lord. Look at the 45th verse. What it says?
A foreigner and an hired servant shall not eat thereof.
Now, glory to God. Woo-wee. I could preach all night on that. A foreigner, someone that's not a part of the body, or a hired servant, that's someone you pay for what they do. He may not belong to you. He doesn't belong to you, but you pay him for what he does. Let me tell you something. A lot of preachers have died and gone to hell because they were hireling shepherds. They preached for pay. They preached for what they could get from the people of God. They were no more than hirelings. Does that mean you can't pay a preacher? You can't give him nothing? No, that's not what that means. But it means that if I'm standing here for a salary, I don't have to care anything about you. I just have to come and perform my job every Sunday. Hello? Or however often you guys require me to be here, as long as you're paying me. You understand? Do you understand? So a hireling, Old Testament, hireling was someone that you hired to do a job, and once he's done the job, you're through with him. He got his pay, and that's all he wants is his pay. You bring that principle over into the new covenant. There are musicians that won't play your organ unless you pay them. That's the truth. Musicians are notorious about that. But they want the preacher to preach for nothing. Supposing I was like that. I'm not. If you guys can't guarantee me an X number of dollars, I'm not preaching. Musicians will come here and sit in your service and see that there's no one on the organ and have the greatest gift ever came out of heaven and will not touch that organ unless you offer him a dollar. We can't have a program where we get the body of Christ together and say, let's put the gifts on display so that we can bless someone. Unless those people that you call to sing or play, they want a love offering. Tell the truth and shame the devil. They don't care how broke your church is. Don't call me to play your instruments and bring my guitars and my horns and stuff if you're not going to pay me. Those are hireling shepherds. Those are hirelings. That person is not worthy of communion. That person is not worthy of communion. And people say, this is the justification. Well, that's how they live. They live by playing their instruments, and people just use you. They sure do. They use us preachers too. I have traveled hundreds and thousands of miles, have I not, Charlene? Charlene was always there with me. People call me and say, oh, Dr. Banks, will you please come and preach for me? We've got 500 or 600 people. This meeting has been scheduled so long, and we know we're going to have a crowd of 500 or 600. Would you come and preach? First of all, I didn't ask you how many of you going to have. That's number one. But I get there, and maybe 5 people. Is that the truth, y'all? You tell me you got 500 people showing up, I'm going to bring at least 200 or 300 books. We lug all those books with us, glory that we get there. We got 5 people sitting there. People have called me to come over. I get on a plane and fly overseas. And I get there, and the young man, he's got choir coming in, and that he done brought in, and he's got all these other preachers he done brought there. Glory to God. And I got up and preached a message. And after I preached, the preacher that was supposed to preach the next day got up, took the microphone and said, this lady can have my spot. And she need all of our spots because she done kill all our messages. She really did. She said she done kill all of our messages. She done kill mine. She done kill yours because I know what you're going to preach. Hallelujah. And she done blow it all us out the water. She can have my time. And she meant that too. And I had to preach at her spot. And then at the end of the, I began to discern this man Glory to God. God brought me there to bring the word into that country, which I have three churches there now. God used him to bring me to that country to put my foot in that country, glory to God, to establish something there. Because I was coming to his meeting, his great big meeting. But that was the will of God for me to be there. But in my discerning, I discerned that this man playing the big shot. He don't have no money. He can't hardly pay for all these people he got here. Because he got to give a love offering to all these preachers that he done called it down, these big shots. And he got this choir he got to feed and whatnot. He done put us up in a hotel, glory to God. So I told him, glory to God, I told him, you know, hallelujah, don't worry about my hotel room. I'll take care of it. I think it was 2 or 3 days we were there. I'll take care of that. I'll take care of that bill. Don't worry about no food for me. I'll take care of me and my helper's food. Don't worry about it. He said, you sure, Dr.? Yes, I am. I'm sure. You worry about it because you can't afford to do what you're doing. Hallelujah. And I'm out of the country. I'm in somebody else's country. If you are hireling, it'll manifest. Because, see, now I was the keynote speaker. I'm supposed to be the main event. So I'm supposed to get more than the rest of folks. I said, no, you take whatever you was going to give me, you give it to them. Because you can't afford it. A hireling is not worthy. If you are money conscious, you're not worthy to take communion. If you do what you do in the house of God just to get some pay or even recognition, come on, somebody. Sometimes it's just recognition. Hallelujah. Accolades. Same thing, same principle. Let me tell you something else. There's a sin called omission. That I see some of you guilty of. Hallelujah. This is really not a rebuke, saints. I'm trying to teach. You guys looking at me strangely. I'm just trying to teach the truth here. Okay. Is that all right? Amen. There's a sin called omission, the sin of omission. And some of you are guilty of omission. Hallelujah. Glory to God. When we are really in tune with God, when you're really in tune with God, this is the place, this church, this is this building here, this is the place where we come, we congregate to hear from God. He's told us to forsake not to assemble ourselves together, didn't he? So we assemble ourselves together. We come here. This is our assembly place. And God has blessed us to be able to, he has extended our congregation to include all of our television audience and our online audience. Something happened to me. I think that's why I'm so light tonight. I don't know if I told you this. No, because it couldn't, because he just happened the other night. Daniel and I were working, and he came in to show me when we launched our application, our BTBN app. We launched that app. Well, back the end of somewhere around July, around about World Conference, and we had problems with the iPhone app because Apple took us through some loops we had to jump through. But thank you, Jesus, we're in the Apple Store now. Amen. That was a good place to say hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. We're in the Apple Store, and we're also in the Play Store for Androids. So you can download us now, the BTBN, on your iPhone, your iPad. Yeah, we're there now. And but he said, Doc, I got the statistics back. I got an email. I got the statistics back from BlackBerry. And there are a lot of third world nations, or nations, period, that use BlackBerry. It used to be very popular here in Jamaica, right? And but it's very popular in a lot of other countries. BlackBerry is still popular. It's not in America. It's not as popular in America because Samsung is just beating them out. Sorry about that, Samsung, but I mean BlackBerry, but it's just the truth. Amen. They've gone around them in sales and whatnot and technology, really. And so, but he got the statistics back, and he opened it up to show it to me. And what they do is they send you a list of every download where your app has been downloaded at. And they tell you the area code and whatever, and the country. And this list, because we're looking at a list now of well over 2,000 downloads. And I'm sitting there, and the list is going on and on and on and on. And I'm looking at all these different countries. That's what fascinated me, that it wasn't like it was a 500 or 600 in America, very few in America, but all the other nations of the world. I'm looking at Italy, France, Argentina, Belgium, the Netherlands, Australia, Europe, all over Europe, UK, Ireland, Switzerland. All these countries, a lot in South Africa, Nigeria, Ghana, Kenya, glory to God. I mean, just on Brazil, on Norway, on the people. I'm like, what? And they would even have the phone number there of the phone that downloaded it. And I'm looking at all these places, all these nations that we're in. Just with the BlackBerry. Hallelujah. And God said something to me. God said to me, he said, when he showed me that, he showed me the Ethiopian, how Philip was translated and brought to the Ethiopian and ministered to him. And after he baptized him, that Ethiopian went into Ethiopia and took the word of God into Ethiopia. And do you realize that the scriptures declare that before the last apostle died, the whole known world was evangelized? God might have took one man and put him in a country and he'd evangelize the whole country because it began to spread. How do you take 12 men and evangelize the whole known world? But he did it. And he didn't have a BlackBerry, an Android, an iPhone, an internet, computers, buses, trains, airplanes, and evangelized the whole known world. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So I'm looking at the power of our God with what he's given us. Hallelujah. Now, where was I going with that? Omission. So now I'm looking at all of these nations on me, and so glory to God. I'm looking at all these nations. But I'm reminded by God that when I come into the household of faith, whatever I am able to do, you don't have to tell me to do it. You look around in here. Let me start with you. You're a recording star. You won the national competition for something. For singing. Gospel artist. Okay. You're a national hero here. And you're sitting in my church. Hallelujah. Now, how long? Let me show you something. Because some people know of God, and some of us know the ways of God. How long do you think God is going to sanction, support, and further your recording career if you are in his house and have talent sitting right next to you and around you that you don't pour yourself into? You have a television audience every week that you could minister to. If you don't, if you see this as small, and you prefer lights, camera, action on a big stage somewhere, if you can't discern that when you stand right here, you're on the biggest stage you ever been on. Let me say it again. You're on the largest stage you ever stood on when you stand right here because you're on five continents. Come on. Amen. So there's a sin of omission if you have gifts and talents that you don't utilize in the household of faith where God planted you. If you got to go over yonder and further that ministry, and go over there and further that. What about your own? Are y'all hearing God? You would not think that that's a sin, but it is. It's a sin of omission. We should have, glory to God, with all these voices, these angelic voices. I got two great recording stars, and I got a Judy Mowat in here. And those devotional teams sound like, whew, when they want to sing, they sing. They have to dress up to do it, but when they, glory to God, if you ever dress them up, they'll sing. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. But when you neglect that, and see, let me tell you something. We should have the greatest choir in the nation. We got all kind of talent in here, all kind of gifts in here, and I've asked for a choir, and I haven't got it yet. I'm going to get one now. Praise you, Jesus. Because if I don't get one, none of the devotional team can take communion. Praise you, Jesus. Because they guilty of the sin of omission. They're going to be guilty until they give me a choir. Praise you, Jesus. Do you see the principle? When you look around you and you see things that need doing, no one should have to tell you to do it. You just do it. And if you're not sure about something, go to Pastor. Pastor Lorna, Pastor Leverage, Pastor Andrew, Pastor Dunnett. Go to some of these pastors. Pastor Sam, and say, you know, I noticed so-and-so, so-and-so. I think I'd like to kind of handle that for you. I can take care of that. That's what saints do. And you know what? You can't say God has never put that in your spirit. Because you would be lying, wouldn't you now? God been talking to her, telling her what she need to do with what she got here. But she been missing in action. This is the longest I've seen her. My God. I've been like, I come in and she's here. I'm like, wow. This is here another night, another day? Great day. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Sin of omission. And when you have, when you're guilty, when God put things in your heart to do in his house, in his ministry, and you neglect to do it because you're preoccupied with yourself and the things that you're doing, guess what? Sin of omission. And you walk right up to the communion table, just as big with that unconfessed sin. And when you examine yourself, you never examine yourself for that. You never go that far. You never go that deep in examination. But God does. God does. Are you hearing him? Hallelujah. Are you hearing God? Hallelujah. Thank you. Notice what he says here. All the congregation is going to eat it. Of Israel shall keep it. But notice something he said here. I don't want to miss it here. They're going to eat it in one house. Don't carry any out of the house. Neither shall ye break a bone thereof. Now we're talking about the Lord's communion. What is the significance here? Let's find out. Go to St. John, the 19th chapter. And hold this. Hold this because we're coming right back to it. Go to St. John. Hallelujah. 19. And let's start at 31st verse.
St. John 19:31.
Mm-hmm.
The Jews, therefore, because it was the preparation. Preparation.
What is the preparation? What are they preparing for? Passover. So they're preparing the sacraments, the supper. They're preparing the roasted lamb. They're getting ready to do the roasted lamb and the unleavened bread and the bitter herbs and the wine. That's they're getting ready for preparation. Remember, Jesus was placed on the cross. He hung on the cross from about 9 o'clock in the morning till about 3 in the afternoon. From the 6th to the 9th hour. I believe that's about 9 to 3. He was on the cross. But it was time of preparation. That meant that they needed to get him off of the cross before 6 o'clock. Because 6 o'clock started this high Sabbath. That Sabbath. Are you hearing God? And the Passover feast. Amen. So now they needed to get him off the cross. Listen to this.
That the bodies should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day.
Mm-hmm.
For that Sabbath day was an high day.
Mm-hmm.
Besought Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away.
Now, they wanted to get them off the cross. So it was Jesus and two more, right? And the Jews wanted to get them off the cross, which leads me to believe that those other two were Jews as well. They needed to get them off the cross before the Sabbath began. before 6 o'clock. So can you just break their legs and kill them so they'll die? Let the shock kill them. Now, you know, that's how you go and ask somebody to do that, for one thing. And but it might have been an act of mercy, though, because, you know, the death of a cross was a horrible death in that you'd hang on that cross. It usually took about 3 days to die on the cross because you'd hang there and your blood would run down. This is why it was so tormenting. The blood would run down and insects would smell the blood, and ants and other insects would smell the blood, and they would come up the cross and they would begin to eat the flesh of that person that was nailed to that cross. And he couldn't move. He couldn't stop it. Amen. And sometimes it just took hours and hours and sometimes 2 or 3 days for that person to actually die. Are you hearing God? So it was probably an act of mercy for them to just break their legs unless you're going to die and going on into hell. Then there ain't nothing merciful about that. Praise you, Jesus. Amen. But they wanted to break their legs to get them off the cross before 6 o'clock. That was the purpose of that, because the Sabbath was about to start. Read.
Then came the soldiers and break the legs of the first and of this other, which mm-hmm. was crucified with him. Mm-hmm. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, mm-hmm. they break not his legs.
They didn't break his legs because he was already dead. He had already given up the ghost. Now listen to what this says here.
But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side.
Now he already dead. You've already established that he's dead. What was the purpose of piercing him? If you've already concluded that he's dead, why pierce him? Read.
And forthwith came there out blood and water. Mm-hmm. And he saw it bear record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith.
Wait, back up again. And he that saw it.
And he that saw it bear record, mm-hmm. and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith true, that he might believe. Mm-hmm. For these things were done, that the scripture should be fulfilled.
Come on.
A bone of him shall not be broken.
Hallelujah.
And again another scripture saith, they shall look on him whom they pierced.
So he had to pierce him. Because Isaiah said, they shall look upon him that they pierced. And remember the first Passover. We read in Exodus. Did not God tell them not to break any bone in that lamb? Because Jesus was the last Lamb of God. He was the Lamb of God, and not a bone in his body was to be broken. Why was not the bone to be broken? Because the broken bone was a sign of division and a fragmentation of the body of Christ. And we are not supposed to be divided. We're supposed to be one. And it's the skeleton of the body that makes us one. It's that skeleton that makes up a whole body. When you break the bones, the skeleton is no longer strong. It's no longer together. Come on, are you hearing God? And so God told them in the very first Passover, don't break the bones of that lamb. And isn't it, look how amazing it was that these people were trying to get Jesus off the cross before 6 o'clock. They're preparing for the Passover, and they didn't realize, glory to God, that he was the lamb that they were preparing to celebrate. He is the Passover. Hallelujah. They didn't realize that they had crucified the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. And so the soldier had to pierce him because the scriptures declared that out of him would flow blood and water, and they would look upon him that they had pierced.
See, when Jesus come back, that's how the Jews are really going to know him. When he comes back, the scriptures say he's going to put one foot, glory to God, he's going to put his feet on the Mount of Olives. And when he put his feet on the Mount of Olives is going to split. He's coming from the east. That's where the Mount of Olives is relative to Jerusalem. And that mountain is going to split when the Lord of glory touches ground. Hallelujah. That's when Jesus comes to the earth, not when he get the church. He get the church, he don't come to the earth. We meet him in the air. Come on, somebody. But when he come back to set up his kingdom and he touches the ground, glory to God, the Jews that are hiding, that are in hiding, that remnant that escaped the Antichrist, the Bible say he's going to come walking toward the eastern gate. And they're going to look at him and say, behold, remember when Jesus was in the temple and they were chiding with him and he said, glory to God, you won't see me no more until you're able to say, blessed is he that come in the name of the Lord. Amen. And when he set foot on the Mount of Olives, they're going to say, blessed is he that come in the name of the Lord, because they will look upon him and they will see the nail prints in his hands and in his feet. Hallelujah. And they'll realize he is the Messiah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Are you hearing God? Are you learning? Glory to God. So that's the purpose of them not breaking his bones, that there be no division in the body. Because the body can't stand. If the legs are broken, the body can't stand. It cannot stand up. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So God did not suffer it to be so. And notice what it says here. And he that saw it bear record, and his record is true. And he knoweth that he saith truth, that ye might believe. Hallelujah. See, the scribes and the Pharisees, they looked upon him. Let me tell you something. Those guys had checked Jesus out. They knew he was born in Bethlehem. They knew he was born under the star, glory to God, of David. They knew it. They knew it. They knew exactly who he was. That's why they crucified him. Because he challenged their position and their authority. And he rebuked them openly as hireling shepherds, making merchandise of the people of God. Whited sepulchers, he called them. Hallelujah. I thank God for Nicodemus. I believe he escaped. I thank God for Joseph of Arimathea. That Joseph. Amen. They escaped. I believe they escaped because they believed. They believed. Hallelujah. Even though they were on the Sanhedrin council, they believed. They believed. They believed. Let us go back now to Corinthians. Hallelujah. Are you learning? Glory to God. Glory to God. I don't know if I'm going to be able to finish this tonight. If not, we'll finish it Sunday. Is that all right? Bless you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Where do we stop at, Pastor? Okay, we're down at Corinthians 11 and 26. Let's back up a minute. Back up. Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Now start right at the 25th verse.
After the same manner, also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do he as oft as he drink it in remembrance of me.
Now, notice what he says here. Now, notice that he's talking to the church. He's not talking to sinners. This is not written to sinners. Are you hearing God? This is written to saints, people that know Jesus. That's who this is written to. You cannot hold a sinner accountable to this. He does not even understand this. Now he says here, this is my body. It was broken for you. Remember, the bread was unleavened. It's unleavened bread, right? Hello? The bread that they used for Passover was unleavened bread. The reason we use unleavened bread is because leaven is a type in the scriptures. It's a type of pride. It represents pride, puffiness. It causes bread to puff up. Come on. You take that dough, and you don't put any leaven in it, it's flat. But it's the same dough. You take the same dough and put some yeast in it, and it's the same amount of dough, but it blows way up. It looks like it's more than it is. And that's what pride does. It makes people look at themselves and see more than they are. So he said, no leaven. And not only that, the Passover was a sacrament that was supposed to be eaten in haste. The Lord told them to gather up their things and eat. And see, that's one reason why you roast the lamb, because he cooks quicker when he's roasted. It cooks quicker. The unleavened bread, it cooks quicker. It cooks faster. When it doesn't, you don't have to let it sit, because they would put the yeast in it and let it sit and rise. It would sit for a few hours and then rise, and then they would stick it in the thing and bake it. No, we're not going to take time for you to get puffed up. We're not giving space for that. Give no space to the flesh. Are you hearing God? We get puffed up when we walk in the flesh. That's a manifestation of our pride. Hallelujah. When we get there, people can't tell us anything. It's hard for people to minister to us. We think we know best. You know, we got the solution for our life. We know what's best. Pride. Pride. Are you hearing God? Are you hearing him? So they used unleavened bread. Now he said, as often as you do this in remembrance of me. Why? Because the bread represents my body that was broken for who? For you. Now you believe that, because you've been a partaker of it, because you are homeborn. You were born into the kingdom of God. Hello? You were born into the kingdom of God. So you know that Jesus died for you. You know his blood was shed for you. You know that. The sinner doesn't know that. He may not even believe it. You believe it, though, because you got him in you. Isn't that right? This was written to the church. Let's keep reading.
Mm-hmm. For as often as he eat this bread and drink this cup, he do shew the Lord's death till he come.
You show the Lord's death until he come. You show his death
The fact that he died for your sins. You are doing, you are performing a ritual here, a ceremony that says, Jesus died for me. I am a product of his death. That's what your communion does. It's just like baptism. Baptism says, I'm not ashamed to confess that I am born of Christ, that I believe in Jesus Christ, that I am a Christian. I'm not ashamed to confess that I, baptism is an open confession. Communion is an open confession that says that I am a manifestation. I am a manifestation. You ought to be able to look upon me and see that Jesus died and rose. You ought to be able to look at me and see that. Hallelujah. Are you hearing God? Let's go a little bit further. We'll prove this.
Mm-hmm. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread mm-hmm. and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily.
Uh-oh. Shall eat it how?
Unworthily.
Unworthily.
Mm-hmm. Shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord.
If you eat it unworthily, you are as guilty as the man that nailed him to the cross. You are as guilty as the scribes and Pharisees that turned him over to the Romans. You are as guilty as the soldier that pierced him in the side. You are as guilty as the soldiers that pulled his beard. You are as guilty as the ones that put the crown of thorns in his head. If you eat unworthily, listen to the Lord, saints. This whole teaching is a wonderful thing for us to perform, but it's also an admonition. He's saying, you can't partake of this ceremony. Don't partake of it. Don't be a part of it if you do it unworthily. What does unworthy mean? There are some definitions that you can just look in Webster. You don't even have to go to the Greek. But they mean the same thing. The words are the same. Amen. Undeserving. Unworthy. Undeserving of effort or attention. Undeserving. No respect. Unfit. In other words, if you eat this, being unfit to eat it. Are you hearing it? If we eat it and know that we're unfit, there's sin in us. Sin. And see, glory to God, you say, well, who can eat then? Those who decide to obey God. Those who walk after the Spirit of God. Those who believe. Those who don't come in and out of the house of God with unrepentant sin. Those who are conscious of their walk in God, conscious to say, I will not sin against God, conscious to say, I will not use the Lord's name in vain, nor would I sit down and watch television shows that do. I will not be entertained by the world. I will not run after the world. I will have no darkness in me. But I'll walk holy before God. That's who can eat of the Lord's Supper. That's who is worthy. That's who is worthy. Shameful. Unworthy means shameful. Iniquity. There's some that have iniquity in their heart. Can't even get over an offense. Might have taken place 2 years ago and you still can't get straight.
Can't get right. Just can't get right. Iniquity. Hallelujah. Unworthy. Discreditable. Hallelujah. Dishonorable. Unsuitable. Unstable. Unfit. Are you hearing God? Ineligible. Unworthy means I'm ineligible. And let me tell you something, saints. I'm going to show you something. Notice what this next verse says. This is very important. I want you to see something here.
But
28.
But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup.
After you have examined yourself, after you have examined yourself, and you have satisfied the Holy Ghost, not when you look at yourself and you think about all of the stuff that you're doing wrong and you say, Lord, I'm sorry. But knowing that when you walk out of here, you're going to do the same thing again. That's not repentance. When it's not in your heart. When it's in your heart to do what's holy and what's righteous, and you got a heart that's given over to holiness, a heart that says, Lord, I missed the mark, Lord. I see some little places where I missed the mark at, but I don't want to miss the mark. I want to be holy. I want to be righteous. When that's real, that's repentance. That's examination. And you shouldn't wait till you get to the table of the Lord to do that. Are you hearing God? You should do that before you get to the table. And let me warn you of something that I heard the Holy Ghost say. Some people have taken communion unworthily because some preacher or some exalter gets up and ministers on or exalts on the mercy of God. And how merciful God is, and people get all hyped and feel good because God is good. And the exhortation is true. But that doesn't mean that your heart changed. Because we get emotional at that time and we feel like we repented, you know, because I'm emotional. But we know when that word has not penetrated and grabbed that darkness and eradicated that darkness out of us. We know when we intend to do the same thing again, or we're not going to walk holy. We know that we're going to fail, and we're going to have to repent again, and we're going to have to fast and pray and try to get right and purge. We already know that, but in that moment of excitement and emotionalism, you run to the communion table. Unworthily. To examine yourself, you must be sober. You don't examine yourself in emotions. You must be sober. And in sobriety, you examine yourself to say, God, I've done wrong. Forgive me. Wash me. Some people need to humble themselves to other people. They don't need to put any excuses on it. They don't need to put any tags on it. Just, I am wrong. And I am unworthy of the mercy of God. I have held things in my heart far too long.
I have ignored, I've sifted the message, I've sifted the word, and I've picked out things that did not touch that piece of darkness that was in me. It's time to get rid of it now. Get rid of all the darkness. For a stranger shall not partake of that table. And sin makes you a stranger to God. Sin makes you a bastard to God. Get rid of the sin. The table is set, but you gotta get rid of the sin. Get rid of the sin. Purge yourself of the sin. Hallelujah. Let us read a little further.
Verse 29.
29.
For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily.
Here we go again. He repeats himself. Mm-hmm.
Eateth and drinketh damnation to himself.
Eateth and drinketh what?
Damnation.
The definition of that word used there, damnation, means eternal punishment. Torment in hell. Listen to God. This is serious. This is very serious. This is God saying, if you come to my table unworthily, you are drinking and eating damnation. I don't care how long you've been saved, but you are eating and drinking damnation because you did not regard the body of Christ and get rid of the sin and the darkness that was in your soul. And you had the ability to do so. You had the ability to do it because I saved you. I gave you the Holy Spirit. And you had the ability to purge yourself of sin. And you didn't do it. So you made light of the body of Christ. And you took this ceremony lightly. And you do despite to the Spirit of God that conducts this ceremony. You do despite to the Holy Ghost. You eat damnation unto yourself. Now listen to what he says here.
Not discerning the Lord's body.
Don't discern. Discern, discern, discern. You're not perceiving, believing, or recognizing. You're not recognizing that this is not just some fad that we do in the church. This is serious. This is us bringing back the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, showing it, showing his death over again. And if we do despiteful to that, if we don't recognize that, if we don't perceive that, stay away from the table. That's what he's saying. If you don't hold it as sacred, holy, as holy sacrament, if you don't see the bread, if you actually don't see the bread as the body of Jesus, then don't eat it. If you don't see the blood as the cleansing power in your life, then don't drink it. That's what he's saying here. Listen to what he says here. If you drink and eat unworthy, you bring damnation because you're not discerning his body. You're not recognizing and perceiving that this is indeed, let me show you something. Let me show you how severe this is. I can give you a very good example. In the old covenant, when Israel sinned, they took the animal and they killed the animal, didn't they? If you committed a sin, you had to bring an animal to the priest, right? And he would offer up that sacrifice on your behalf. What happened if you didn't bring it? God killed you and put you in hell. That blood of that sacrifice covered your sin, right? That was an animal that died in your place, in Israel's place. But it covered, his blood covered their sins. Didn't remove them, but it covered them so that the death angel would pass them by. That's why they call it Passover. And God is saying, if you don't discern the blood of Jesus, death will not pass you by. This is the Passover. But those who partake of it must believe in it. And they must respect it and purify themselves. Sanctify their spirit, their soul, from all filthiness of the flesh. Sanctify themselves. Purge themselves of all unrighteousness. They must discern that this is the body of Jesus. This is my Lord being crucified for me. I'm showing his death. And if I don't regard it, if I don't recognize it, if I don't perceive of that, then it won't be Passover for me. Because death will stop here. Are you hearing God? Are you hearing him? Hallelujah. He said, examine yourself. Notice what he says in the 30th verse.
For this cause, many are weak and sickly among you.
Sickly. Oftentimes sick. Not in good health. Just sickly. Always sick. You know why? You know when you are sickly, you are dying. You are partaking of the devourer. He's devouring that body. He says, for this cause, there is many that are sickly and weak in the church. People let that they push their kids up to take communion. The kids don't even know what they're doing. Kids have no, they don't even have a clue. They don't have a clue as what they're doing. This is a ministry that follows the apostolic doctrine, not Catholicism. Are y'all hearing me? In Catholicism, everybody takes communion. Not so in apostolic order. Not so. Are you hearing God? Are you hearing God? You just push your kids up and go, take communion, go, go. And then you wonder why your kids are sick all the time. Why are they sickly and weak? And notice what it said. Some are sick, weak, and sleep. That means they died. They done fell asleep. They done fell dead. They have died because they took it unworthily. Are you hearing God? Are you hearing God? Notice what some people say, well, you know, they just went to sleep. They all right. Look at the 31st verse. How do you sleep inside of damnation? I don't want to go to sleep in damnation. Look at the 31st verse.
For if we would judge ourselves.
If we judge ourselves. Uh-huh.
We should not be judged.
In other words, people are sick. People say God won't let afflictions come on you. Yes, he will. People are sick, weak, and dying at the hand of God because they have not discerned the body of his son, Jesus Christ, that died for them.
Mm-hmm. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord.
We are who? Chastened. We are chastened. We are chastised. Hallelujah. We are chastened.
Of the Lord.
Of the Lord.
That we should not be condemned with the world.
Now he says, if you judge yourselves, If we judge ourselves, if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord. God will chastise us. God will let sickness come among us. He'll let weaknesses come among us. Trying to warn you. Damnation. He's trying to warn you so that you don't enter into it. That you don't that you be not condemned with the rest of the world. Look at the 33rd verse. I only got 2 or 3 minutes left.
Wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for another.
In other words, linger. Wait. Don't do this hastily. If a brother is not there and he need to repent, let him repent. Let him make it real. Are you hearing God? Give him time to make it real. Don't just put it on the program as another item on the program. Communion is another item on the program. We at communion now. Let's get it going. Let's get it going. No. Make sure that you've given people an opportunity to examine themselves, because a brother might consider, I don't need to do this. I need to wait till I'm in the right place with God. Now, let me tell you something. It's quite possible that some of you don't believe this teaching, because you've been taking communion all your life. And it's been drilled in you to take communion. That's just a big thing in the church. Take communion. That's why God told me to suspend it in here until you teach on it. You need to teach it. We don't need to be in ignorant of the ignorance of these things. And that's why I took my time and let the scriptures do the talking. I took you from scripture to scripture. And as I said earlier, when someone take you to the scriptures, that ought to be enough. Clap your hands and tell them thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I hope that you that are watching by way of television have enjoyed the teaching tonight. Glory to God. We are going to have communion this coming Sunday. Those of you that are watching this broadcast tonight live, we are having communion this coming Sunday for those who are worthy. Hallelujah. Join with us. Get your sacraments. Get your sacraments. Have them there at your house. Examine yourself. Cleanse yourself. Purge yourself of all sin and be able to take communion with us this coming Sunday morning live. This is Dr. Banks and all the BTI family saying we'll see you next time. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give him praise. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Amen. Bless the Lord.
If you are not walking in holiness as a leader, somewhere, something, you're either going to steal,
come on, Doc,
you're going to kill,
yeah,
something.
And a sonship.